You're watching the News on 6, judged best newscast in Oklahoma by the Associated Press.
Not so long ago, it was a land without rules.
A place of great hazard and heartache. And even today, there are those who maintain the best way to travel through the Oklahoma Panhandle is quickly. But Oklahoma traveler Scott Thompson and photojournalist Grant Girondale slowed down and looked around. Turns out they found beauty, human and otherwise, of no man's land.
To find the heart of a place, stand and look in all directions. Sniff the air. Reach down and grab a handful of grass. Ponder your place in the world. Do that in the Oklahoma Panhandle and you will suddenly feel very small. This is where the sky, shaded the most glorious blue, stretches on forever until it meets the butterscotch winter grasses of the high plains, and there they disappear together below the horizon. This is a place of great extremes and great distance. Time marked by searing sun and wicked wind. Distance to the nearest neighbor measured in miles. Those few who live here are closer because of that.
The behavior of people toward one another out here is very important to me, and I think one of the important assets of the region.
Ken Turner oversees the collection that tells the story of the Panhandle at the No Man's Land Museum, of the outlaws and Indians and ranchers who shaped life here.
There are still people who come out here that can't wait to go away because they can't stand the sense of openness and isolation.
Randall Bench went away for 13 years, brought a meteorology degree back home, and set up shop in the old Logan Post Office.
Just about every little town around here has been hit by a tornado. It shows you that they're rather common.
He built a fiberglass thunderstorm and a cotton ball cold front, teamed them with a tornado lamp.
The tornado lamp is nice, except it has one problem. It rotates the wrong direction. It's a southern hemisphere tornado.
If you've got a few moments, Randall will show you one of the thousands of tornadoes he's got on video.
I saw this particular tornado when it occurred May 15th, 1991.
He'll give you a forecast if you're traveling through.
Yeah, wind shifting to the north, turning a little cooler. They're made in El Reno, Oklahoma.
Oh.
So it's an Oklahoma product. It says Oklahoma Twister right here on the top.
And Randall pays homage to the 38 blizzard and the 35 dust storm. Panhandlers know the weather can be friend or foe.
It's part of our heritage.
When government treaty makers and surveyors were carving up the West with state and territorial boundaries, something odd happened. A huge rectangle of land was mistakenly forgotten, left out.
The real reason people called this no man's land primarily was because it was no man's land. No one could own it.
There was no law, no government, for 50 years until no man's land was stuck onto Oklahoma territory. Hal Clark's grandfather arrived in 1877 when cattle ranchers were trying to establish themselves on the barren plains. Two-thirds died or gave up within 4 years of moving here, but not Hal Clark's grandfather. And now the family cattle wear the oldest brand in the Panhandle.
Do you sometimes feel as if you're forgotten out here?
Well, sometimes we get that feeling. Sure do. I had one fella interested me say, he said, maybe we ought to just swing the Panhandle loop downtown on the west side of Oklahoma so we'd be a little closer to Oklahoma City.
They are closer here to the state capitals of Denver and Santa Fe than to their own. And in the crossroads of Kenton, at about the spot Oklahoma runs out, they are behind the times by an hour.
Well, it's 1:25, and the rest of Oklahoma is 2:25 right now. So we're just on mountain time. Always has been, hadn't it, Billy?
That's Billy Bullard, the mail carrier from Clayton, New Mexico, in for lunch, who says working two time zones doesn't bother him.
No, not me.
This is the only Oklahoma city on Mountain Standard Time.
It's a village. It's not a very big city. About 45 people, isn't it, Betty?
And like other places of the Panhandle, folks learn to adjust. Life's not taken so serious here where the mastodon tusks mix with the Butterfingers and Baby Ruths, and the library comes in a box.
If I call a beauty shop or the doctor's office and make an appointment, when they say 2 o'clock, I write down 1 o'clock.
For all its desolation today, the Panhandle was once witness to one of the greatest adventures of American history. In the 19th century, a branch of the West's major trade route, the Santa Fe Trail, passed through here. The trail still visible where the grass grows a darker color, and still held in honor by the locals.
Coffee and tea.
We made a meeting of trail boosters, a chili supper, and slideshow by Nebraskan Les Vilda, who has twice walked the length of the trail.
I saw this, the sun was shining just moments before.
Interesting on a screen, fascinating at Dan Sharp's ranch.
We have recorded, 323 names.
Cold Springs Creek never runs dry here, so the great caravans of the Santa Fe Trail made it a point to stop, and they would carve their names on the rock bluff.
So, but anyway, the thing is, if you have spare time, whether you're fixing harness or playing with the oxen or whatever, you might have went over and put your name on the rock.
The soldiers and the merchants and the roustabouts left a bit of themselves behind here to remind us of Indian attacks and cholera and loneliness.
More than likely this was 2 or 3 at one time, and they just wrote it out to be one depression. Hmm.
And then Dan took us to the farthest reaches of his spread, and there we stood in the ruts of the trail they left and wondered of the great wagon trains that preceded us by a century and a half.
Interesting to think of all the fortunes and hopes and dreams that rode on this road.
And that's the main thing we try to get across to the younger kids that come out and, you know, and see the rock and stuff, and we show pictures and stuff too, is once you can see a picture of a person that actually is on the trail, and you can get across to them that they had hopes and dreams and laughed and cried just like the rest of us, well then it's not just a name and a date, well it becomes real to them.
Laughter and tears and dreams have always stitched this place together. Courage and grit provided the ballast, and come day's end, given a lucky few like Ken Turner, the chance to spy the Milky Way, count falling stars, and be glad the sky never ends over a place called No Man's Land.
That sort of opportunity is, I think, important to us in our everyday lives. Each day I feel a little bit more part of nature, if you will, because I'm overwhelmed by the universe when I step outside.
Scott Thompson, The Oklahoma Traveler.
You're watching the News on 6, judged best newscast in Oklahoma by the Associated Press.
Oklahoma can't claim the Rockies or the Smokies were more like an ironing board, long and flat.
But every state has a high point, and it's in no man's land that Oklahoma traveler Scott Thompson and photojournalist Grant Girondale find themselves looking down on the rest of us.
There are those who say the Oklahoma Panhandle is a monotonous place, long stretches of nothing. But just before the state hands itself off to New Mexico and Colorado, the flatness runs up against Mesa country. And up there, on the Black Mesa, is as high as things get in the Sooner State. Our hiking companion today is Richard Romero. He's the assistant director of state parks, and he's got a key, which, I'll admit, gets us 3 miles closer to our starting point. TV equipment can get awfully heavy. This beautiful, stark land is part of the 1,500-acre Black Mesa Nature Preserve.
Here we are. We're right here. Mm-hmm. And we're going to hike up this trail here. That's the top of the mesa right there. And then we'll hike across here and over there. And that's the High Point Monument. That's the border of New Mexico right there.
We're almost right out of Oklahoma here.
Yeah, I mean,
it's a half mile to the top.
It's this first 500 feet that's the hard part, so just pace ourselves on this.
Along an old rutted cow path, But cows don't come this way anymore, not since the Nature Conservancy bought the land and turned it over to the state to shelter bobcat and bear, 23 rare plants, 8 rare animals, and to protect the views we share with the past.
So you can imagine a convoy of wagons coming over the horizon and the history that you could have seen had you just stood up here.
Yeah, I often, look out there and think about, herds of dinosaurs roaming the area.
They would have been here 65 million years ago. The footprints they left behind tell us that. Looking at an ancient sea, perhaps, had they stood where we do now.
So you're above all the landforms now. You can see, begin to see the peaks and the...
Did we see Colorado from here?
Oh, yeah. That's...
Colorado,
that big long mesa with the peak behind it, that's Colorado.
And New Mexico is...
New Mexico is right over there.
We still have a mile and a half to go before we reach the state's highest point. Our escort across the mesa turns out to be a herd of pronghorn antelope.
Oh, 13, 14. It's about 20. Yeah, all right. Good herd.
And they can maneuver these rocky cliffs and things.
Oh, yeah, they'll go right down over the edges. They're amazing. Well, good. Glad we got to see him.
And finally, up there, a sphere of marble pokes its head above the buffalo grass. It's here that Oklahoma stands its tallest, just about 4,973 feet. The marker placed in 1954 by the old Tulsa Tribune. Its sides serve as a compass point for places far and near.
West
1,299 feet.
1,290, yeah, feet. Los Angeles is only 895 miles. Everybody has to sign the logbook when they come up here.
In a brittle old stenographer's pad, the hikers who've come before leave a thought or two of the time they stood higher than anyone in Oklahoma. Here, where there is no sound of humankind, no sight of civilization, inspiration comes easy, and no one leaves without a new sense of being alive.
Robert Carr, Amarillo. Look all directions and thank God for this country and what we have today and tomorrow and in the future. Great sunrise. I hope my wife has not given birth to our second child yet.
And for what it's worth, we leave a bit of ourselves here too.
Came to the top. So a great many other Oklahomans could too. Hate to go back to the city where there is noise and chaos.
To stand on the side of the mesa is to stand in awe of the Cimarron River Valley, of a landscape born of fire and ash. There, the extinct volcanoes of New Mexico. And there, Rabbit Ears, a guidepost on the Santa Fe Trail.
This is volcanic rock.
This is the Black Mesa rock.
And that's the uniqueness of the mesa is this is the only one of the mesas that have this black top on it.
A lava flow that began in present-day Colorado, 35 miles away.
No, this was a lava flow, and that's what makes it different.
Just because I could, I stepped across the barbed wire and cedar post fence that marks the New Mexican border.
You ever been to New Mexico before?
Never been to New Mexico, except right now. Feels a lot like Oklahoma over here.
Does?
Oklahoma's prettier, though. I'm coming over.
Because back home, we were in a special place. No one stood taller this day. No one closer to the clouds and the moon. No one as appreciative, perhaps, to be alive, to see the world spread out before us from atop Oklahoma. Scott Thompson, the Oklahoma Traveler.
And tomorrow night at 10, Scott drops in on Boise City more than 50 years after Army Air Corps bombs did the same thing. The Oklahoma Traveler in No Man's Land continues tomorrow at 10.
What a beautiful piece of landscape we just got to look at.
I feel like I was on a great journey.
Oh,
Scott took us there.
It was wonderful. And you know, the Nature Conservancy is to be commended for making sure that's preserved.
It's really
that's
important
wonderful.
Work.
Yes.
You're watching the News on 6, judged best newscast in Oklahoma by the Associated Press.
In the Second World War, our enemies were clearly defined, good and evil, quite distinct.
And luckily, the scars of war were inflicted far from our shores. At least that's what the people of Boise City, Oklahoma, went to bed that night thinking. Oklahoma traveler Scott Thompson and photojournalist Grant Arondale gather the earth-shattering facts in no man's land.
July 5th, 1943 was just half an hour old. The good folks of Boise City were fast asleep. The 4th of July had been a good one. The red, white, and blue made more significant because of the Great War raging on two fronts. It all seemed so far away from the high plains of the Panhandle. And then it started. From the darkness above came the drone of an airplane engine, dropping its payload on Boise City. It was an Army Air Corps B-17 flying a training mission from a base in Dalhart, Texas. The crew, mistaking the four streetlights surrounding the courthouse for the lights of their intended target, a bombing range 40 miles away.
They were within a block, several of the bombs they dropped. So
they were close, but they were 40 miles off.
Right, yeah.
Norma Jean Young was 18 years old that night and can still pinpoint ground zero on the courthouse square.
Okay, here was the first one, right?
Okay, right. Pretty close to that pole up there.
They were 100-pound practice bombs. The first blew F.F. Bork's garage apart.
It was right along in here.
And this was an apartment building. People sleep in there.
Yeah. And I'm sure it woke them up. And after they hit this, they circled and came back, and right there is the Baptist church. Now, at that time,
the second bomb skimmed the church's back wall.
I'm a Methodist. I have a Baptist friend who belonged to this church, and she said, you know, if that had been a Methodist church, that thing would have torn off that back wall.
The third bomb fell on this sidewalk. Three others came down in rapid succession, one falling next to a gasoline truck whose driver had stopped at a cafe.
Across the street, I guess he was in there drinking coffee. He got back in that truck and he took off, and we haven't seen him since.
Six bombs fell in all there around the courthouse. After half an hour, the barrage stopped when the town's electrician turned off the street lights.
The next morning, my folks ran the newspaper office, and the place was full of brass from the Air Force Base over at Dalhart. They had FBI men there and everybody you could think of. And they told us that it was just a mistake, that they were real sorry it happened, but it wouldn't happen again.
At least not to the crew responsible for the bombing. They were given the option of a court-martial or going to the front lines, 7 weeks short of completing their training. Apparently, their attack on Boise City proved their skill.
They had a new navigator. That was the problem.
No one knew it at the time, but it was navigator John Daly who pointed the warplane towards the Panhandle.
The regular navigator was in the hospital, so they put this new guy on the plane. Here they came.
No one was hurt that night, and the next day, Norma Jean, there in the hat, posed in one of the bomb craters. The mayor set up a table in front of the targeted church.
They sold war bonds all afternoon. Boy, they really rolled the money in.
In fact, Boise City puffed its chest out in pride at being the only American city bombed during the Second World War.
Well, you can imagine what would happen if that happened today.
Oh!
You'd have a legal army down here.
Oh, yeah. Gee whiz, we could have sued the heck out of that bunch. Really had us a great town here.
Boise City turned out pretty good anyway. Folks made a monument to that fateful night on the courthouse square, a replica of a bomb tilted in the cement towards the Texas Air Base. And attend a meeting at the community center, and there, sharing space with a drum and a tuba, is half of one of the original sand and gunpowder projectiles. The children of John Daly, the navigator, came back once to see the town their father tried to wipe out. Daly and the rest of the crew that bombed the town went on to win a chest full of medals, and even led the entire 8th Air Force on the first daylight bombing raid of Berlin. How history would have changed had the folks of Boise City insisted on a court-martial. Goats can become heroes in the blink of an eye. Mistakes happen, they'll tell you here. But embarrassment can be reversed, and failure needn't stand.
There's the hero.
There's the hero. That's the fella who's the navigator.
And he's your hero because?
Because he put Boise City on the map while trying to destroy Boise City.
Scott Thompson, the Oklahoma Traveler.
After the war, Boise Cityans learned they weren't the only ones to feel the business end of American bombs. It happened to towns in Texas, Nebraska, and California. Still, the panhandlers claimed to be having the most fun with their bad luck.
Boy, they sure had a good sense of humor.
Oh, she's a delightful woman.
They were great sports about it. I don't know if a bomb, practice bomb woke me up, I'd be rather upset.
They were lucky. I'm so glad no one was hurt, but that was a great story.